Okay, thank you for coming, and thank you, thanks for the organizing, for letting me speak. So, some of you might already heard this talk, but I believe it fits nicely with other talks in the conference. So I'm talking about Gyárfás-Sumner conjecture. It's a joint work with Bruce Reed, and I'm at McGill. So I will remind you the conjecture. It already was mentioned in Vaidi talk and maybe in some others. So the conjecture says that essentially if we fix some tree and we are looking on the family of all the graphs that doesn't contain this tree T as induced subgraph, every time I will say T-free or H-free, I mean in the induced sense. So the family of all graphs which are T-free is chi-bounded, which means that there is some function such that the chromatic number of G which is T-free is bounded by the function, this function of the click number. So there are a few families of trees for which the conjecture is known to be true. So Gyárfás, in the same paper that Alex mentioned in the previous talk, showed that the conjecture is true for passing stars, and also the proof for pass was sketched by Alex. And then there were some additional results for trees for radius true, two, which are trees which are subdivided stars, some other family of trees, and there is a continuing work for additional families of trees by Chudnovsky, Scott, and Sim. So the results are, the proofs are, appear to be quite hard, and the bounds in those proofs are usually high. So the function is usually exponential or even larger, the function of the click number, which bounding the chromatic number. So we focus, I focus on family of a subset. Essentially, I want to say something about almost all graphs which are T-free or H-free. So I say that something true for almost all graphs if the proportion of these graphs versus the size of the whole family goes to one. Okay, so almost, so I will consider the property of almost all graphs in a family. So in this setting, for almost all T-free graph, we can show that Gyárfás-Sumner conjecture is true. So again, I fix some tree. I'm looking on almost all T-free graphs, which means it's not all the graphs in the family, but the proportion goes to one versus all the T-free graphs. So for them, the Gyárfás-Sumner conjecture is true, and the bounding function is very good, is linear or almost linear. Okay. So how we do it? How we show the coloring result? We show it by first showing some strong structural result. When we know, so we show that the almost all T-free graphs have a structure which is, we can partition almost all T-free graphs in some constant number of times, which I will specify what is constant in a minute, such that the graphs, the subgraph on each one of the parts has a simple structure, and I will explain a bit more what I mean by simple structure. So once we have this structure, the coloring becomes quite easy because the structure is simple enough that it can be actually reduced to a clique. So almost all T-free graphs can be reduced some constant size of cliques, and then coloring these cliques is again equivalent to finding perfect matching in a random graph where for the probability for every H is constant, but I won't go into the details with that. I maybe just say that, again, once we have the structure, the coloring problem becomes simpler. So, yeah. So let me say what, again, what I mean by this number of structure, number of parts, and what I mean by simple structure. Okay, so let me define a parameter. This will be my constant. So a way to understand this parameter better is to think for a second on the value without the minus one and, for example, on the chromatic number. So the chromatic number of a graph is a minimal number such that minimum number k sets, we can partition the graph k into k stable set. If I chromatic number minus one is the maximal number T, such that we cannot partition into T stable set. So this parameter actually mixes not just stable set as in a chromatic number, but stable set and cliques. So if I don't consider this minus one, then this is the minimal number such that for a, every A and B, we can partition H into A cliques and stable set. And maybe, let me show an example. So maybe you encounter this number under different names. It's also denoted as tau of H, binary chromatic number, or in some paper as colouring number, which is, might be a bit confusing, but so maybe you know it under this name. I will denote it as WPN of H. So if we're looking on these two graphs, for example, so that WPN of C5 is 2 and WPN of P3, what I denote as P3 star, which is essentially this graph, is 2. So why is it 2? Why is WPN of this graph is 2? It's because if we look on every sum, every A and B that sum to 3, which is 2 plus 1, then we can partition into this number for A, any A and B, this number of clique and stable set. For example, we can partition into 3 cliques, 2 cliques, 1 stable set, 1 clique, 2 stable set, 3 stable set, which is essentially 2 stable set. So, so the number here will be 2 because we can, for every sum of 3, we can partition, but there is some choice of 2 cliques or stable sets that we cannot partition it into this number of cliques or stable set. In particular, in this example, it will be 2 cliques. So we cannot partition this graph into 2 cliques. So the value, and we can get partition into any set of 3 cliques or stable sets. So the WPN is 2. And WPN is the constant that I want. So this is a constant. So let me tell more about the simple structure. So let's think how we can get, let's say, I will do it with an example. Let's say my graph is C5. WPN of C5 is also true, 2, sorry. So how we can get an H-free, a C5-free graph? So one way is we just take some big graph G that we know that we can partition into two stable sets. And with any choices of edges in between, this graph will be C5-free, because C5 cannot be partitioned into two stable sets. So this is an example of a C5-free graph, but we can do something more. So we can also put a clique here. So C5 cannot be partitioned into one clique and one stable set. So this will give also an example of C5-free graph. And actually, we can do something even more. So we can, let's say, keep a clique here. But here, we can allow any graph which is disjoint union of cliques and any choice of edges. It, again, will give a C5-free graph. So let's, like, those are some possible partition of C5. We can partition it into a vertex and P4, an H and P3, non-H P3 bar. No matter how we would like to put one piece in one part and another piece of, in another part, we still, we cannot do it because this is the way I chose it. So for any partition of C5, this, there is, we cannot embed the pieces of C5 in a clique and a disjoint union of cliques. So this is another possible way to get a C5-free graph. So let me do it a bit more formal. So let's say PH is a set of all partition of H into this WPN H parts. And we say that partition is PH-free if for every partition from PH, there is some index of this partition of G, such the piece of HI is not induced subgraph of GI, as we did in the previous. So for example, this is a C5 free, PC5 free partition, because for any partition of C5, there is some, we cannot, if we put an edge here, we cannot put P3 here. And if we put a vertex here, we cannot put P4 here. So this is what I mean by pH-free partition. And let me mention a conjecture by Bruce and Alex that for every graph H, almost all H-free graphs have this partition. So we cannot promise it for all H-free graphs. We can easily think about the example, but it won't be true, but almost all have such a partition. And such a partition, this is a simple structure partition that I was mentioning before, because how we build it, we know a lot of information about the graphs on the parts, which have a very convenient structure. And this conjecture is verified, it's true. It's true for cliques. It's true also for cycles. So even cycles and odd cycles, when actually the result of Balgo and Butterfield is a bit more general than just odd cycles, they have a larger family of graphs, but odd cycles as one is a subset of this family. Okay. So let me talk a bit. So you don't have to read it, I will explain it. Let me talk a bit of how we can prove this structure, what is our approach for proving this structure. So the starting point is a theorem by Reed and Scott that can be, it's based on a result of Alone, Balog, Balabash, and Morris from 2010 about the structure of almost all graphs in heredity property. But from the result, this theorem can be derived, and what does it say? So for every H and Xi, there are some constant rho such that almost all H-free graphs have a partition into this WPNH part that we want, such that all the parts are of almost equal size. Moreover, each of the parts can be partitioned into two parts, which let me call Xi, or actually Pi. So this should be Pi prime. So whatever we have on those parts on the axis, or Pi prime, is actually pH-free, as we want. But there is some small exceptional set. Why is it small? OK, here I say that it's small, its size is sublinear in the number of vertices of G. So N is the number of vertices of G. Okay, and so I will have one more condition, but maybe I will say it again. Whatever we have here is pH-free, and those parts are small. And if we know that we can get rid of this part, we actually prove in the conjecture, which means we actually get this pH-free structure, and this is what we want. We want to show that actually the set Zi must be empty. There is one more condition, but it's useful in the proofs, but maybe it's a bit not clear why we need it, but essentially it says that whenever we choose some vertex in one of the parts, its neighborhood is very close to the neighborhood of some vertex of in some constant set size P. Again, it's maybe we can put that aside for now, but yeah, the previous condition are, I think, more clear why we would like something like that. Okay. So let me again say a bit more about how we could prove what we want to prove. So we want to prove that actually, for almost all T-free graph, H-free graph, the set Z must be empty. So we show it by showing that allowing the set Zi being non-empty, if we allow some vertices in the set, we might get some more options for graphs on the part, in the part, but we will lose some options across the parts. So we are counting, we want to bound the number of graphs which have the number of H-free graphs which have Zi non-empty versus the number of graphs which have Zi empty, and we want to show that the number of graphs with Zi non-empty is asymptotically smaller, as little o of the number of graphs with a set that I empty. And this gives us the structure that we want, because whatever we have on the XI already, the pH free structure, the simple, the easier structure to deal with. Okay, so let's think about this tree. So let's say that this is my H, this is my T. I want to prove that for this tree T, my statement is true. And let's assume that that one is not empty. So I didn't tell you, but it's possible to show that actually the pH-free partition for this graph gives me those parts XI. Those parts will be should be cliques. There will be cliques. It's not hard to prove that on the XI I have a clique. So if I take a vertex in Z and Z1 and it's not part of the clique, it means that I have some non-H here. And then I have essentially two, so here is my non-H from the previous slide. Those are cliques. You will need to believe me, but it's not hard to show that those are cliques, which means that we have many disjoint edges as it being a clique. And we think about, so we choose some maximal set of disjoint edges. We think about every edge here is a copy of E1 here, and every edge here is a copy of E nu t, when nu t is the size of the maximum matching. Again, you will need to believe me that the WPN t in this case is the number of edges and the matching plus one. But yeah, so we think about the edges here as copies of E1, as edges here as copies of nu t, and we have two options. So we are looking on this non-edge, so again, we gain some options here, but we are now looking on the options across. So we have two cases, when the first one that there is some set, so we are looking on the all the ways to join p1, p2, this non-edge to the edges in P2 and PWPN. So either this non-edge has a limited neighborhood on many of the copies of edges here. This makes us lose too many options. Or it has the good neighborhood, the neighborhood as in the tree with respect to many of the parts, and then we need to forbid, because we are counting edge-free graphs, we need to forbid some option across. So yeah, I didn't show you exactly the computations, but the bottom line that the number of options, the extra options we get here, having those non-edge doesn't add us too much options. We lose more options by looking on the edges across. And this is what helps us with the count, that the number of graphs with that being empty is much larger than the number of graphs with that being non-empty. And this is a brief sketch of the idea. And let me finish with a bit of possible future work. So we can try to use, and we actually did, use the framework to solve other problems. So where such a framework would be useful, it will be useful in problems that that we can say that there is some set of forbidden induced subgraphs. For example, here we could prove that almost all string graphs, which is actually a geometric problem, string graph is intersection graphs of strings in the plane, are actually intersection graphs of plane convex. So the framework is, the problem sounds quite different, but just because both of them essentially problems about, so we can characterize the family with some set of forbidden induced subgraph, then we could show this kind of statement, that structure of almost all string graphs. So this is one direction. A different direction is to try to prove more of graphs H. So we work on trees. The conjecture is proven for cycles. Maybe the next step, so this is intermediate step, would be to try to show it for bipartite graphs. And maybe the next step, for triangle-free graph and maybe for all graphs H. So this is all. I will stop.
All right, are there any questions for Elena? Anyone?
You know that Gyárfás-Sumner conjecture is decidable in the sense that I'm trying to draw a parallel between Hartwig-Gerow's conjecture and this. There are some similarities. I mean, Hartwig-Gerow was proved to be true for almost all graphs, and that's exactly
yeah.
what you want. The next step, maybe what people did was to prove that it was decidable, Hartwig-Gerow's conjecture.
So I don't know how directly derives it. It's because there are still many graphs. If just to conclude something based on the structure, there are still many graphs that we do does not necessarily have the structure that we want. And I mean, it still seemed like a big space of graphs. So maybe there is, but yeah, I don't see it immediately.